In the previous class, we have seen the characteristics and quality attributes of embedded systems. Today, we will have a look at the embedded systems, that is application and domain specific. We are going through two particular examples of embedded systems. The first one, we will take application specific embedded system. And an example for this is a washing machine. A washing machine, which is a very common household or home automation application. It's a home appliance, you can say. It is an example for application-specific embedded system. So it's a typical example of an embedded system providing extensive support in home automation applications. So as you know, embedded systems, we have seen the different components of embedded systems, right? Embedded system should contain sensors, actuators, control unit, then application-specific user interfaces like keyboards, display units, etc. So you can see in the washing machine, all these components are there. The sensors, actuators, control units, and interfacing units. Okay, all these components we can see in a washing machine. So this gives the functional block diagram of a washing machine. If you have seen it, you know, now these days most of them have it at home. Even if you do not have, you might have seen it somewhere. There will be two types of washing machines, basically. When it comes to fully automatic washing machine, that is front loading and top loading washing machines. So what we are discussing here as an example is fully automatic washing machines. So prior to this, and even now, there are semi-automatic washing machines available where the complete process of washing the clothes is not done by the machine itself. You know, the humans will have to interfere in them, you know. For the washing will be done somewhere, but for rinsing application, humans have to interfere, remove the clothes and take it to the other container and those things, that is semi-automatic. But what we are considering is a fully automatic washing machine where the complete washing process is done by the machine itself. So here it contains different components. You can see there is a water inlet pipe where the water is let into this tub. So there are actually two tubs. One is the outer tub and the inner tub. Outer tub is a stationary one, whereas inner tub is a moving one. Then there are sensors like temperature sensor for if you have a provision for hot water, then a level sensor to indicate the level of water. Then here, what you can see is a agitator. Agitator, it's actually to rotate and it will cause the movement of water within the container. Then there is an outlet pipe for water outlet to let the water go out of the washing machine. Then there is outer body case, as you can see. And at the top, you know, there will be a panel, or you can say integrated control panel with user interface. There will be some indications with the help of LED, and there will be some interface like for keypad for input. There will be like a start button maybe there. Then to select different modes for different types of load you put into the machine, light, medium, heavy. Then for different operations, wash, soak, and rinse. And for the different durations, maybe 30 minutes, 1 hour, 2 hours, right? Depending on the manufacturer, these interfaces, you know, they differ. Overall, it contains everything. You can see there is a sensor, there are sensors, there are actuators, which are actually the rotating action or the washing action that is done, that is through the actuators. Then there are interfaces, and there is a control unit with some microprocessor or microcontroller, which is programmed, and that is there inside the control unit. The actuator part of the washing machine consists of a motorized agitator. Okay, motorized agitator is that which allows the movement of water. Then the tumble tub, the tub that you can see at the bottom, and the water drawing pump and inlet valve to control the flow of water into the unit. Okay, then the sensor, it consists of water temperature sensor, level sensor, and other things. The control part contains microprocessor controller based board with interfaces to the sensors and actuators. So there will be a control unit actually with the microprocessor or microcontroller, which is programmed. So based on the user interface, whatever the inputs you give and based on the sensors, some actions are performed with the help of actuators. And to do that, you know, the control unit plays a major role. The sensor data is fed back to the control unit, and the control unit generates necessary actuator outputs. Okay, The control unit, it provides connectivity to user interfaces like keypad for setting the wash time or selecting the type of material to be washed, like if it's light, medium, heavy duty and other things. Okay, and also for what kind of operation you're performing, like wash, rinse and soak. Those are different options provided. Or there might be other things, you know, depending on the manufacturer of the machine. Then the user feedback is reflected through the display unit and LEDs, which are again present on the control board. So as I said, there are two types of fully automatic machines. You can see there is a top loading washing machine and front loading washing machine. In top loading washing machine, the load is put from the top. That's why the name. And in front loading, at the front, you open the door and put the clothes into the machine. In terms of its performance, front loading washing machine is better than top loading washing machine. But the thing is, front loading washing machines are expensive and they consume more power compared to top loading washing machines. Okay, so they come in two models, that is top loading and front loading. In top loading models, the agitator of the machine twists back and forth and pulls the cloth down to the bottom of the tub. That is, from the top, it comes to the bottom in the flow of water, and the agitator causes this flow. On reaching the bottom of the tub, the clothes work their way back up to the top of the tub. When the agitator grabs them again and repeats the mechanism. So they will be continuously moving from top to bottom and bottom to up. And in this process, the clothes get cleaned. Okay, in the front loading machines, the clothes are tumbled and plunged into the water over and over again. Okay, so it's a different mechanism that is used in the front loading machines. They're tumbled and plunged over and over again. Okay, so you might have experienced this personally at your homes, or you know, you can even watch YouTube videos of how these machines actually work. This is the first phase of washing. Well, that is to wash. Once the clothes are washed, then they have to be rinsed because there will be soap in them. Okay, so they have to be rinsed with clean water. So that means the water which is there, it has to be drained out. Okay, water has to be drained out. Then fresh water has to be brought in, and again the same process has to be repeated. That means in the clean water, those washed clothes have to be clean, rinsed, and again that water has to be let out. So in the second phase, water is pumped out from the tub, and in the tub uses centrifugal force. That is, it rotates very fast, you know, to remove the water, to wring out more water from the clothes by spinning at several hundred rotations per meter. So at a very high speed, it will rotate. With that, you know, water goes out. So that's called the spin phase. Okay, so by spinning, the water is removed. The inner tub of the machine contains a number of holes, and during the spin cycle, the inner tub spins and forces water out through these holes to the stationary outer tub, from which it is drained off through the outlet pipe. So as we have seen here, there are two tubs. Outer tub is stationary, I said. Inner tub will rotate. When it rotates with that centrifugal force, all the water will go out, and where it goes is into the outer tub. To the outer tub, there will be a connection of an outlet pipe from which the water will be drained out. So for rinsing, again the same process is done, with the fresh water coming in, and again it will rinse, and again the water is let out. And even it gets dried, you know, if it rotates at a very high speed, the extra water, whatever is there, it will be removed, and it is as a function of, it's actually a function of spinning. So the design of washing machines, they again vary from manufacturer to manufacturer. That's what I said, but the general principle remains the same. Okay, general principle of washing machine, they remain the same. The basic control consists of a timer. So there will actually be a timer for different modes, you know, there will be different times preset by the manufacturer. Then the cycle selector mechanism to select what cycle it is, whether it is wash cycle, soak cycle, or rinse or spin cycle. Okay, then the temperature selector, if inbuilt heater is there, you know, for hot water, it lets in hot water. If you want to wash clothes in hot water, then it will heat the water and input it, otherwise normal water. Then select the load size, whether it is a heavy load or light or medium, or depending on that. And then a start button will be there. Then the mechanism, it includes different things like motor, then the transmission for changing the speed and all, clutch, pump, bring in the water, agitator to rotate the water, then two tubs, inner tub and outer tub, and the water inlet valve. So these are actually form the part of actuators. Okay, the water inlet valve connects to the water supply line using at home and regulates the flow of water into the tub. So that is to bring in the water. Similarly, there will be an outlet valve to let out the water during the spin phase. So this is one example of an integrated control panel that you can see in a washing machine. So this is supposedly a control panel of a Whirlpool washing machine. So depending on the manufacturer, again, it will change. It will not be the same. These are the different cycles. You can see that there is a soak, extra soak cycle here. Soak means the clothes will be soaked in the water before the actual wash process starts. Then there is wash, rinse and spin. This is a timer to indicate how much time is remaining. Then there are two modes. You can see express wash for faster washing and delay wash. Then different things are there, different modes, you know, daily, heavy. If it's heavy, then different mode is there. Delicate clothes, different mode is there. White clothes, different mode is there. Okay, so different types of cloth you use, different levels are there. And you know, the capacity is mentioned here, 7.2 kg. So again, different machines will have different capacity. And here it indicates the water level, how much water you intend. You can control that also, right? And some softener, okay? You can use different modes for that. Warm, hot, or gently, different modes. Okay, this is one example of washing machine's panel. So this again will depend on the manufacturer or the company of the washing machine. So it consists actually of a microprocessor or controller based board with IO interfaces and a control algorithm. Control algorithm that is based on the program that is written in the microprocessor or microcontroller. The input interface, it includes the keyboard, which consists of wash type selector, like you can select wash, spin and rinse, and cloth type selector like light, medium, heavy duty, and washing time settings. Okay, the output interface will be displays in terms of LED or LCD and status indication LEDs, or there might also be some tones, some buzzer or some beep sounds or some tones which indicate the completion of the process or something like that. Okay, the other type of IO interfaces which are invisible to the end user are different kinds of sensors like temperature sensor, water level sensor, and the actuator interface, including motor controls for agitator, tub movement control, then inlet water flow control, etc. So these are the things we see in the washing machine. Okay, it's a simple thing. Just like any other washing machine, it will also have a sensors, actuators, the control unit, and user interface things. So, okay, then we have seen there are two types of that. What are the sensor part, what are the actuators part, and what is the function of control unit, and what are the interfacing user interface things. So this is what we have seen in one, by taking one example of an embedded system, that is in the case of a washing machine, which is used in your house, which is used as a household appliance. The next example of embedded systems we will take as a domain specific embedded system, that is automotive domain we will take. The major application domains we have seen, they can be consumer electronics or industrial domain or automotive domain or telecom domain or networking domain, right? Or healthcare. So there are different domains where we use. So telecom and automotive industry, they hold a big market share. Okay, so this gives an idea of which are the different embedded systems we use in automotive domain. So there are more than this, actually more than this. These are just to indicate. You can see there is an instrumentation thing in the dock or the dashboard. Okay, then engine control, fan control for ventilation, and for fuel injection control, for headlamp control, for ABS anti-braking system, for wiper control. Okay, then for suspension control, then for locking, centralized locking of the vehicle, for power windows, okay, for mirror control, then seat control, airbag control, then power steering for air conditioner. So these are all few of the examples. Okay, so we can also have like for reverse monitoring, right? Then obstacle detection. There are many other things that you can add into this. And as the standard of the vehicle increases, there will be more number of embedded systems included. So this, we have taken one example of a basic model of a car and seen what are the different embedded systems which you can find in an automotive domain. So automotive embedded systems are the one where electronics take control over the mechanical systems. As I have been saying, you know, automobiles or cars or whatever, they are no more just mechanical systems. So there are more number of electronic components in them than the mechanical ones. The presence of automotive embedded system is in a vehicle, it varies from a simple mirror and wiper control to complex airbag controller and anti-lock brake systems. So these are, you know, lifesavers. Airbag controller and all, they are lifesavers. From simple mirror to these kind of life-saving things, we have so many number of or a wide range of embedded system products. So there are actually electronic control units, we call them ECUs, which are used in automotive embedded systems. They're normally built around automotive embedded systems. They're normally built around microcontrollers or DSPs, or a hybrid of the two. That means they can be both microcontrollers or DSPs, and are generally known as electronic control units. So the number of ECUs or electronic control units in a vehicle, it depends on the type of the vehicle. Okay, an ordinary vehicle, maybe it may be around 20 to 40, but in luxury vehicles like Mercedes or BMW, okay, there can be more number, like 75 to 100 number of embedded control units. So depending on the type of vehicle, there are the number of embedded or electronic control units vary. The government regulations on fuel economy, environmental factors or and emission standards, and increasing demands for consumer safety, comfort, and other things like infotainment, like multimedia applications within the vehicle, they force the automotive manufacturers to opt for sophisticated embedded control units within the vehicle. These days, you know, there are more, so much, we find so much sophisticated vehicles in the market. Whereas the first embedded system used in automotive application was in 1968, no? So early, it was 1968. It was the microprocessor-based fuel injection system. So for fuel injection in the motor, microprocessor was used. That was the first embedded system which was used in this particular domain. So the vehicle was Volkswagen 1600. That's the name of the vehicle. It was in 1968. Okay. And when we come to these electronic control units, they actually fall under two categories based on the speed or where we use them. Okay. So one is high speed electronic control units. Other one is low speed electronic control units. These high speed electronic control units, we use them in critical control units, which require a very high speed or a fast response, a quick response, like the airbag controllers, okay, or maybe fuel injection systems or anti-lock braking systems, or in engine controls or electronic throttle or steering controls, or transmission controls and central control unit. We need a quicker response in such situations. There we use high speed electronic control units. There are some other applications where response time is not so critical. There we use low speed electronic control units. So they are generally built around low cost microprocessors or microcontrollers and digital signal processors. So some things like which are not critical, like audio controllers, okay, passenger and driver door locks, door glass controls, mirror controls, wiper controls, seat controls, then headlamp and tail lamp controls, sunroof control units, okay, then maybe seat belt monitoring, whether the driver or the passengers have worn their seat belts or not. So those things, to control them also we use control units. So they can be low speed electronic control units. So when we say there are embedded systems, for proper communication, we need some connections between them. So for that, we use communication buses, and the automotive communication buses are used for that purpose. They make use of serial buses for communication automotive applications make use of serial buses for communication, which greatly reduces the amount of wiring required inside a vehicle. Okay, since you know there has to be wires for transmitting any signal, so if it is a parallel communication at a time, that there has to be more number of wires paired together. But if it is a serial bus, the amount of wiring will be reduced. So there are different types of serial interface buses we use in automotive domain. There are three types normally: controller area network bus, that is CAN bus, local interconnect network LIN bus, and media oriented system transport bus, that is the MOST bus. Okay, we will see them one by one. The CAN bus, it was originally proposed by Robert Bosch. Robert Bosch is one of the leading industry or leading company in automotive embedded solution providers. It supports different speeds again, like medium speed and high speed. Medium speed is in particular ISO standard, that is class B, ISO 11519 class B standard, with data rates up to 125 kbps, and high speed comes up to 1 mbps. Okay, so it is an event driven protocol interface with support for error handling in data transmission. Event driven means when some event happens, as a response to this something has to happen. That is called an event driven protocol. It is generally employed in safety systems like airbag control, powertrain systems like engine control and anti-lock braking systems, and navigation systems like GPS. Okay, in these applications we use CAN or controller area network type of bus, serial bus. Then we have local interconnect network bus, LIN. Okay, so it is a single master multiple slave communication interface. There can be only one master and up to 16 independent slaves connected to this particular bus. So it is a low speed bus, a single wire communication interface with support for data rates up to 20 kbps. So it can support only up to 20 kbps, compared to up to 1 mbps in the previous one. And it is used for sensor actuator interfacing. All the sensors and actuators, you know, whatever we have, those for interfacing, that we use LIN bus, local interconnect network bus. So it again follows master communication triggering technique to eliminate the possible bus arbitration problem that can occur by simultaneous talking of different slave nodes connected to a single interface. Since it is a single bus connected to different devices, okay, there can be only one master, and the master will initiate the communication. Okay, thereby it eliminates the possible of bus arbitration, means bus shared between, when the bus is shared between different slaves, they should not communicate between each other directly. So the master will trigger the communication. That is the approach used here. So LIN bus, it is used in applications like mirror control or fan control or seat positioning control, window control and position controls, where response time is not so critical. Then the last kind of the bus we have is MOST bus, that is media oriented system transport bus. So it is targeted for high bandwidth automotive multimedia networking, like whatever the multimedia systems we have inside the vehicles, like audio video or infotainment system interfacing. So it is primarily used in European cars. It is a multimedia fiber optic point to point network implemented in a different topology, like star, ring or daisy chain topology over optical fiber cables. So the MOST bus specifications define the physical layer as well as the application layer, network layer and media access control layer. Okay, so these are the different layers of communication networks which you will be going through in your communication network subject in the 7th semester. Physical layer actually means the actual connection, like the electrical and optical parameters, since it is an optical fiber cable. Then application layer, network layer and media access control layer, they are at the higher levels. MOST bus or media oriented system transport bus is an optical fiber cable connected between two things, that is electrical optical converter and optical electrical converter. So most of the signals are electrical in nature. Okay, so when you connect two electrical components via optical fiber, there has to be converters on both the sides. So more on this we'll be again studying in optical fiber communication or fiber optic networks, which you have in your 8th semester. But to keep it simple, so where optical fibers are used to connect two devices optically. In that means when optical fiber is used, the electrical signals, they have to be converted to optical, and back the optical signals have to be converted to electrical. Okay, so this bus acts as that particular thing which connects these two converters between electrical optical converter and optical to electrical converter, which would translate into the optical cable MOSFETs. Okay, so that's what we have about the different types of buses in automotive domain. Okay, so what we have seen as an examples are two different examples. In application specific embedded systems, we have seen washing machine as an example, and in domain specific embedded systems, we have seen automotive domain as an example, and we have seen how the things are in each of them. Okay, likewise, there are different types of applications. You can see even in them there are all the components. You can just see any embedded, you can take an example of any embedded system around you and try to figure out what are the sensors in them, what are the actuators, okay, and what are the types of interfaces are there, and what the control unit does in them. Okay, so this way it will be a practical way of analyzing or understanding the embedded systems around you. So in the next class, we will go through the next topic, that is hardware software co-design and program modeling.